Okay, so I think we can start the last session before tonight's party. And so I would like to give you a quick demonstration of the S2S web database. Tomorrow morning, so we will have a lab session. And actually, the main goal of this first week is what my hope is that by the end of the first week, you'll be fluent in retrieving data from the S2S database through the data portal and through web API. On the second week, next week, then would be more about really more science exercise on science. So tomorrow, I think the session will be more about retrieving data simply from the data portal. And I will give now a quick demonstration of this database, data portal. So first of all, here are the important links you need to be aware of. I think for me, there is one you need to remember, and personally, that's the only one I can remember, is the top one, which is www.s2sprediction.net. This is a website for the S2S project, and which contains a link, an easy link to find for all the three other web pages. So this one, the second one, https.ismwf.int datasets data S2S, is the S2S portal at ismwf. So if you click on this directly, you get directly into the data portal. Maybe we can write it on the table, or?
Yeah.
Should have written before. The second one is https://2s.cma.cn index. So that's an easy one to remember. And that's the S2S portal at CMA. It opened just a few days ago, actually. I am not too familiar about it, so we won't go through this one. We go to the ECMWF one. And also an important link is this one, the last one, software.ecmwf.int, the wiki, which contains the wiki pages for information on S2S. So there's some very useful information about it, and it also contains a link to the data portal. So we plan actually to change the address soon to have something more like the CMA one, but yeah, it's not the case yet.
This
is abstract, yes. So if you go to s2sprediction.net, so you'll get this web page, which, as I mentioned this morning, is the S2S project web page, contains all the latest information. So like as CMA S2S data portal is now open. You can link here. As I said, you have the coming events and so on, the latest S2S news. And you have this menu here, which is a database. And if you click on it, then you have four links. The first one is S2S database is more information. But here you have the data portal on ECMWF, which will bring you so directly towards this data portal. Data portal is CMA. Our model description, which is in fact a description of the S2S database. Okay? So for me, it's the easiest way to navigate through all of this. And if you go to the wiki pages of the S2S data page, web page, then you get this web page where you have the latest news and you have several also links to parameters, list of parameters, instruction, progress status. I will go to that. So if you, for example, click on the first one on the left menu, you have a news. If you click on news, well, you have the definition of the project, which is a long text describing the S2S project. So you have all the details of what I've, more or less what I mentioned this morning. If you go to the, that's in description. If you go click on models, that's an important web page because it gives you the latest status of each model, the latest configuration of each model. This is, for example, status from 1st of July 2015. So you have all the 11 models. What is their time range, resolution, and sample size, and so on. And this is something that will be updated each time a new there's changes in the model configuration. For example, for ECMWF, in the early stage of the S2S database, we are running the model only up to 32 days. The reforecasts were only once a week with 5 ensemble members. And since May 2015, we have extended to 46 days and so on. So this represent here the latest status. And if you click on each model, then you get an in-depth description of the model physics, model initial conditions, all the information you need to know about this specific model.
Do you have the information on this page about the dates? Those versions were actually...
Yes, exactly. I mean, I can give you actually more in demonstration here. So this is now a live demonstration. If you go to model description... So if you go to S2S, description, models, so if you go to ECMWF, you click on it, it will tell you latest version of the model, it tells you the cycle, which is a bit obscure maybe for most people here, but it tells you it has been operational since 14 May 2015 included. And it gives you, if you click here, it gives you the latest model description. So you see Ansible version, configuration, initial conditions, perturbation, model uncertainty, you have a lot of details about the model physics. But you can also get from the old version, cycle 4101, which was before 14 May, and it tells you what it was, what was the difference. So you can see through these pages what was the different configuration of the model, what are the changes from one configuration to another. Okay, so if I go back to the PowerPoint. So that's quite a fairly important piece of information here for each models. And if you go, well, I will go later on to more the details, but that's, I think, the most important one to know now. So getting the data. To get the data, step one is to register. And we can do that live. If I go back to S2S project, I click on data portal. TCMWF. So that's a web page usually you get when you go to the data portal first thing. And first thing you have to do is please log in before retrieving data from the data server.
It's really the script slightly larger. Is that, can you read that from the back of the room on the screen? Should I make it larger than actually?
It's okay. It's quite big. So if you press login, either you have already registered, so you need to put your user ID and password and then log in. Or if you are not registered, as Adrien said, you are welcome to, not welcome actually, more than that, to register tonight, requested to do that tonight. And to click the register now, so it's very simple. You just put your first name, your last name, what is your email address. And importantly, to you accept the terms of conditions. I know it's very tempting to not to read them, it's a bit boring. But I think it's important to read them at least, to have at least a first look at them. I mean, there's some important piece of information about them, particularly about the redistribution of data. So if you take data from ECMWF, what is the law, what we have the right to do with it? And that's quite relatively strict, actually. We do not recommend people to redistribute the data. One reason we don't want people to redistribute data is that sometimes we can notice after 5 months, for instance, that one model, one variable is completely wrong. So we have to fix it in your database. And if people start to redistribute the database data before, then you have different versions of the data circulating and people can start to get lost about it. So please have a look at the term of conditions. Then you type the text here and you simply register. So it's a very simple process to do. So maybe Adrien will look because I don't know my password by heart. Oh, it's a wonder, sorry.
Oh,
it's wrong. Okay, so I'll log in. Okay, it's going, yeah. No, didn't like it. Maybe we waited too long. Okay. Okay. So now, once you are registered, non-sign-in, this is how the web page should look like. So you have no more this big warning. So you will see that in this web page, you have a menu on the left, which asks you if you want a real-time forecast or a re-forecast. So we start with a real-time. Then you can choose which model you want. So as I said, there are 7 models available now. We hope to have a few more by the end of the year, and all of them quite soon, early next year.
Yeah,
that's the default, yes, because that's what everybody will do. And what is important too is that you have different type of variables. So you have some variables are instantaneous and accumulated. For example, total precipitation is accumulated. Those are available 0, 6, 0, 24, 48, and so on. And you have some variables, as I mentioned this morning, which are daily averaged. And that's the case of 2 meter temperature, for example, which is an average from 6 hourly outputs. So it will be, for example, if you click on it, you will see immediately that the steps look different. This time the step look 0 to 24, 24 to 48, 48, 72, 72, 96. So they are always 24 hourly. Okay, then you can choose if you want a control forecast or perturb forecast. So control forecast, as was explained by Adrian, is a simple the first realization. A perturb forecast, then you have another menu where you select the number. And of course, what is nice with this interface is that this number will be associated to the model you select. So if you select SMWF, you will see you can go up to 50 members because that's a 50-member ensemble, 51 member if we add the control. But if you choose, for example, CMA, you will see you just have 3 numbers because that's a 4-member ensemble. Okay? So the first one is exactly like for era interim. You select the date you want. So you have 2 ways to select dates. Either you put from date A to date B, from a start date to end date, or you can alternatively select a month. You can say, I want all the real-time forecasts for January. And what is nice with it is that, for example, for ECMWF, we don't have a real-time forecast every day. We produce a real-time forecast twice a week. But you don't need to know that. It will automatically know which date to take and to upload. So if I go to ECMWF again, because that's the one I know the best. So here you can select ensemble member number 1. You want step 2448. For parameter for 2 meter temperature, for example, for 2 meter dew point temperature. So, like for era interim, if I could take, for example, real-time instantaneous fields, you can see you have parameters steps every 6 hourly, but not all parameters are 6 hourly. So if you select a 10 meter U wind, which is 24 hourly, you see immediately that some time steps are great, cannot be selected. And you can select 0, 24, and so on. So that's a nice point of this interface. It can tell you what is available, what you can really download. Even if you don't know a priori what is a model configuration, it's a visual way to know what is inside your model. So once you do that, you select January, you select step 24, and you select 10 meter U winds. Then you have 2 options. You don't have 3, unfortunately, like for era interim. For era interim, you have the 3rd option, which is netcdf retrieval. And there is a way to do offline retrieval of conversion of netcdf, but this is a menu that will come automatically later on. Yeah.
So when you're first investigating this data set, it's a good idea when you're first investigating only to look at one variable at a time to get used to the availability, because if you click on 2 or 3 variables, they have different step availability, then it can be a little bit confusing then when you get the file, because maybe one of those variables is only available every 24 hours, but it shows all the time steps because it's showing it for a variable which is more often available. So it's best to start simple with just one variable at a time. It won't crash or kill it. This means that when you get the file, you'll have different frequency for each variable that's in the file, which then can be a little bit confusing.
Another important point I need to mention is that the list of variable provided is not the same for all models. So the list of variable I mentioned this morning is the expected list for each model. So some models are, some centers are providing the whole list, is the case of ECMWF or CMA. But some other centers are only providing a subset of those variables. So not everyone, for example, is providing soil moisture during the over the top 20 centimeters. So to know, so when you click here, you will see a list of variables, and that's really the list of variables that are available. But if I click another model, let's take Météo France, for instance, you will see that it's a shorter list. Actually, it's not obvious. This one has quite a lot. Maybe GMA, as in GMA. Still a lot. But just more daily average, actually. If I go to real-time daily averages. So that's what you get with the CMWF. So you have quite a long list of daily mean variables. But if you go to GMA, you will see this list is much smaller. Okay, so that's another way to discover what you can retrieve, what is available. And that's why, I mean, this database is what is called a discovery tool. So you have two options so when you select parameters. Something that is also interesting is that for GMA is a very specific model because they provide all the other models, the forecast start at 0Z. So day one is step 0 to 24, day two is 24, 48, and so on. But GMA start at 12Z. So day one is, in fact, as you can see, step 12 to 36, 36, 60, and so on. So that's a particularity which you can see here.
Sorry.
Yeah?
So let's say that I'm interested in ECMWF, and I only want to study, I don't know, one of the star dates. You said that you have like 2 eyes per week. No?
Yes.
So you also said it's really neat because this system, you know, will manage everything.
Well, you can select your date here. If you know your date is a Monday on the, or is either a Monday or Thursday, you can specify the date here. For example, 1st January 2015 was a Thursday. If you just want this Thursday, then you specify I want for 2015-01 to 2015-01-01. And then you will get only one single date. And then you don't put anything here. You step, I want step 024, okay. Sorry, oh yes, 020. Yeah. 01, two dash, yes. 10101. I want 024 for 2 meter temperature. Okay, so here I have two options. One is to view the mass request. So that, as Adrian already mentioned, is something very useful. It gives you an indication on what the retrieval should be. So I will go to that later on. It gives you an example of Web EBI script. Or you do the mass request. You go back to, so it's a Python code to retrieve the data. Okay, the problem here is unselect everything. So I reselect things, and I go to retrieve grid. And then you say, and here you have two nice options. One is to say, by default, you will retrieve the data globally, but you may just want the data over a small portion. And then you can click here on area where you say, I want to change the area. And you specify, if you do that, you can just select here which is the north bound of your domain, western, south, and east. And then you can retrieve a smaller domain. Yeah?
Sorry, coming back to my original question. So if I want that A, but for, I don't know, several years, I will need to do that for every year?
That's a real-time forecast. This is a real-time forecast, not the reforecast. I will go to the reforecast later on.
That thing I was talking about where you can look at the real operation forecast, which was time in that direction in my schematic, or go back over the same date, which is time in that direction. I was referring to as
that would be more or less official, official way, yes. There are several ways, reforecast or Ancast. But normally the official way is a reforecast, normally.
Well, what this means for real debuggers is that once you do not have, once you are not on this website on Tuesday, you have to go to reforecast to get it.
No.
It's always here. Real time are always all the forecasts that were produced for real time use.
Yeah.
So it starts from here. You have all of them since 1st of January 2015. You have all of them till now. Yes.
It's a small pause. It's like a dual act, isn't it? Like a comedy performance. So today. Going off into the future, you were 48 today. Okay? That's a real-time forecast. You can't actually get it today because there's a lag of 3 weeks before they release the data. Okay? On the same date, November 2015, there's also 23rd November 14, 13, 12, and so on. Back roughly 20 years. That depends on the model system because they have different reforecasts, like you call them forecasts. So what Frederick is showing at the moment is just accessing this one forecast now for this 2015, which is done every Monday and Tuesday, Monday and Thursday for the use of WF system, for the Met Office system every single day. So tomorrow, 24th, they will have four more forecasts. 25th, four more forecasts available. Whereas for the Eastern WF system, you have to wait until today was Monday, so there will be forecasts due. On Thursday, there'll be another forecast due. Okay, so on the 4th, 5th, 6th. And then on the 26th, there'll also be the same forecast due. Back into the past, the last 20 years.
So there's no overlap.
The overlap, yes, because this forecast from the 23rd of November, that goes forward 48 days into the future, okay? And this forecast is made 3 days later, and this is also going 48 days into the future. So if you look at the forecast for Friday, you can take Thursday's forecast at a lead of one, so it's advanced times 1 day, or you can look at Friday's forecast from Monday, so you've got a lead of 4 days, or the Thursday the week before, so it's a lead of 8 days. Essentially you've got, this is going like this, and then you've got another plume, and another plume is overlapping. So at the moment, when Frederick's looking at this date range here, that is looking at just this year's operational forecast, going forward in time this way, when he's got a data stream. So it's just the forecast, but it's not looking at the hindcast associated with that. Okay. Again, it's probably my fault. I probably didn't make it quite clear enough when I was showing that diagram earlier. You almost have almost two time dimensions, which in fact is the reason why the NetCDF is not there yet, because NetCDF was also very confused with having two time dimensions, because you've got time of the forecast time, it's 48 days, and the start date. Then you've also got the time associated with the hindcast date, which is the hindcast associated with this present day date. So you remember I had that little diagram, I had a little bunch of forecasts like this, and then I had it again for the next day. So what we're doing at the moment is we're just looking at the really big ensemble for this year, but we're not showing you how to do the hindcast ensemble
yes.
that's associated with that in order to be able to calibrate it.
So I will go to that later on. Yeah. Yeah? Another question?
Sorry, so many questions. So when you say January,
yes.
So it's taking, you know, the whole month, and it's like using an equally weighted ensemble mean?
No. It will give you all individual forecasts,
oh.
which were produced in January.
Okay.
So in this case, we get the forecast from 1st of January, 4th, 5th of January, 8th, and so on. Yes. Yes. But it's not a monthly mean. Huh? Yeah. Yeah. No, it doesn't make sense, no.
So how, I mean, you know that people would
when we download the particular file that will contain all the example members from the application.
Well, here you can select. You have a way to select what you want. Here I am in control forecast. If I go to pattern forecast, you will see for each model, you will have a new box, which is select the number. For example, if we have a 50-member ensembles, so you can select all of them if you want, or you may want just one ensemble member, and then you just select one. You say, I just want the ensemble for some obscure reason. You may want ensemble number 8.
So there are only 50 here, if you notice.
Yeah.
And that's, again, that thing I'm not quite...
I've never been quite happy with that, actually, the way that the retrieval method is not like you have a number 0 or anything.
Yes.
It's like a different way of making.
So because your ensemble is 51 members, but your first member, your control, is not member 0. It's actually referred to differently as the control. So that's why in the menu on the left, you actually have two options there.
Control.
Control. That's like... Member 0, and then perturbed is members 1 to 50. So you have a 51 member ensemble, but there's one that's like, shall we say, stands out because it doesn't have the perturbations applied
yes.
to it, and the other 50 do have the perturbations applied to it.
Can we call the control the deterministic focus?
Not really,
no.
Because deterministic, that terminology is normally referred to as the short to medium range, very high resolution system.
Okay.
The control has the same resolution as the ensemble.
Mm.
Again, that's why I wanted to give the overview of the systems. So remember, the ECMWF system has a very high resolution run that only goes out to 10 or 15 days.
10 days,
okay? It's just a 10-day single forecast. But you're throwing all your weight into that. That's got the really finest grid, the smallest grid boxes. That's what's known usually as the deterministic system. Okay. So that on the EPS gram of the Trieste forecast, that was one of the solid lines. Okay. Now, forget about that for the moment. For the EPS system, that's the intermediate resolution that goes out to 48 days. That has 51 forecasts. Okay. But just to confuse you all, one of those forecasts has the same resolution as all the others, but it doesn't have any stochastic physics. There's no perturbations applied to the physics. Okay, so it's kind of, in a way, they kind of treat it as, okay, this is my best central kind of forecast, and the others are all perturbations around that. Okay, like I said, I particularly, myself, I'm not so keen on that way of doing things because, I mean, we can talk about it offline, but scientifically, it does actually restrict the way you can do your stochastic physics because... You have to be very careful the way you set up your perturbation. You really want to think 51 members as being just one big ensemble. It's it's a little bit confusing because one of those 51 members is identified separately because it isn't perturbed, and the other 50 are perturbed, but they all have the same resolution and the same setup. Okay, it's just that one of them hasn't got any perturbations. That's what's slightly confusing. But it's not the deterministic, that's a very high resolution 10-day forecast system. And that's called deterministic because there are no ensemble members perturbations, it's just one single run.
What they are saying is that if you want to pick one member, then pick that same member.
Pick the control, yeah?
Well, yes and no, in a way. It's a little bit of a scientific issue, a mute issue. They have always traditionally treated it in that way. So they say, well, we're not perturbing it. That's perhaps our central model. That's our best model, the one we use for the deterministic system, okay? But in a way, your perturbations are supposed to be sampling your uncertainty. Okay. So let's just imagine a very simple example, your initial conditions. You might have an uncertainty in temperature of 1 degree. Okay. So you say, well, this is my analysis, but I've got an uncertainty. So really, in a way, there's... It depends what your distribution is. Obviously, if it's Gaussian, then you would say you've got a high probability of being in the middle or the edges. It depends how those distributions are. So if it were a uniform distribution, your uncertainty, then all of the ensemble members would be equally likely. So how you answer that, it kind of depends on your weighting of your uncertainty. You see what I mean? So you can say, in a way, the control is supposed to be in the center of that distribution, and the others are perfect around those, you see, and you'll have outliers in the ensemble. But what you'll often find, okay, if you look close to the EPS gram, is, and that's something that often causes alarm, is sometimes you'll find that you've got the envelope of the perturbation, like the EPS, and quite often the control will be almost a bit of an outlier.
Yes, it happens. Yeah. So because of progressive physics. Yeah.
Yeah, because of the stochastic physics and the way it's set up. So you'll find that...
because it's not the exact same model version, if you can say.
Yeah, in a way. So it's nuances at the end of the day. If you want to just take one member, you might want to take the control. On the other hand, you might want to actually look at the ensemble mean, because then you're averaging across, say, your uncertainty. So you want to either use the ensemble mean or probabilistic ways of evaluating your model. Remember, come back to the example of the umbrella. Because it, especially when you get onto longer ranges, it's not like just rainfall for the next day where you're quite happy that your evolution of the deterministic dynamics is deterministic. It's where you have the deterministic system for the very short range. When you get onto longer timescales, you only want to sample that envelope of uncertainty. So taking one member on its own is often not the best thing to do, not the thing you want to do, because you instead of having a... Remember that example, it was a little bit grainy, but the example from the Peter Bauer Nature paper, right? All those little scan maps of the rainfall, well, probably if you took any one of those, it's going to be perhaps quite wrong. Probably a much better way to show information in the kind of weekly timescale is to show the probability map, you see. And it's the same way as when Frederick's showing results from the S2S system. He wouldn't be showing, okay, this was the skill at like day 27. It would be looking at weekly anomalies of temperature, you see, and looking at the statistics across the ensemble. Sorry.
It's okay. A question, yeah?
For the case of modeling comparison,
yeah.
So the number of ensemble between two models should be the similar, or we can compare the ECM level with 51 member with the other model with 10 members?
Well, there's different ways to combine multimodals, actually. To produce multimodal. So it's different.
Just for comparison.
I think it's better to, if you want a clean comparison, to have the same ensemble size. Because a lot of scores are very strongly dependent on how many ensemble you have, particularly probabilistic skill score.
And then the problem will be how to select 4 members out of 50.
But it was a very good question.
Yeah.
And one of the things here, I mean, especially because the way the ensembles are set up, it is different. You have these lag ensembles and so on. And your skill, I mean, it depends on the question you want to answer. But say you wanted to make a direct comparison between ECM WF and the Met Office. There were the two systems I demonstrated and the two I'm most familiar with. So ECM WF has 4 runs per day. So in 1 week, you've got 28. So probably I would tend then towards perhaps taking 14 and 14 members of the ECMWF. So in the week, you've got 28, and you're averaging it over a week. So one of them has a smooth, like I was saying, lead time advantage. The other one has 2 bursts. But your information over the week then, in terms of the ensemble science, so if you wanted to try and compare somehow the actual quality of the model physics and initialization methodologies, it's difficult to split those. But then I would take 14 and 14 members of the ECMWF Monday and Thursday starts and perhaps compare that. Again, it's not quite in the middle because, of course, Monday and Thursday are not 3.5 days apart. They're 4 days apart, so it's still not exactly the same. You have to think quite carefully. And this is why Frederick was saying that the S2S database is a lot less... it's a little bit more of an advanced user database in terms of you have to think a little bit more about how you pull these things and compare them and combine them, because there's much less standardization in the way the systems are set up, because we're in that kind of intermediate ground between, you know, the short, medium range GPS, which you have to do dynamic stuff on the fly. And
because for the case of the NMME, we are sure that at least each model will have 10 members.
Yes.
But for the case of the S2S,
depends. Each model has its own configuration. Yes.
Yeah, like 4 and 50 are very different.
But yeah, it's 4 and 50 because it's 4 every day.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you combine
twice per week.
Yes.
So there are some models with, but if it's 4 daily, you've got 28 per week. At ECMWF, you've got 102 per week. So it's a factor of 3 still, but it's not a factor of
25.
Okay. And using
That depends. It's not just because you have an ensemble, you're averaging, it's not necessarily the case that your ensemble mean will be smaller. Because if you had a modeling system which your model physics is doing a good job, if you think you have an anomaly of 2 degrees, yes, you have an ensemble perturbation around that, but that ensemble perturbation might go from 1 to 3 degrees. Okay. So it depends. One example, like you say, recently, is for example with the Met Office system, when they had they showed for the first time, there was this really nice paper this year from Adam's case group looking at the NAO prediction. So the Glossy 5 system for the first time seems to have predictability to the NAO. A very good correlation, but the signal's much weaker in the ensemble. Okay, so we need to look and try and work out why that is. They have another example where that happens a lot is if you look at interannual variability of prediction of rainfall in the Sahel. So a lot of models can get the decadal variations in the rainfall in the West Africa, in the monsoon, if they drive them with observed SSTs. But again, the signal's much weaker, which means there's something wrong there. Maybe land surface interactions are not amplifying the signal in the way you think they should. Maybe the aerosol signal's wrong. But it's not automatically the case. It's just because you average an ensemble, you get a weaker signal. What you really want is in a system where the ensemble mean has the right anomaly. Some of them will be stronger and some of them will be weaker. So you get the right signal on the average. So it's not automatically the case. That does happen. You can also get systems which are too active. And so you average and your ensemble mean is actually larger than the observed signal.
But the level mean it's not
the best way, and it's not actually, it's not the only way, and it's not always the best way. So you can take an ensemble mean, but there are also ways you can look at a forecast probabilistically, which is actually better for an ensemble system in the longer term, rather than just simply averaging out. Because if you average out and take the ensemble mean, you actually lose information in that process. So the averaging process, you're actually removing information from your forecast system. So there are lots of probabilistic ways, which are not used as often as they should be, actually, even within the member states of the Eastern WM. They're not taken advantage of. So we will be showing some of the ways of probabilistically evaluating forecasts as well. A little bit like I was trying to give that really simple taster example with the umbrella earlier. I know I was being a little bit flippant, but I think it shows an important process. You wouldn't just take the mean. You know, you want to look at the probabilistic information that's contained in those forecasts.
Let's continue. I mean, if we have questions more, we can do that at the end, maybe, that we finish the demonstration. So, as I mentioned before, you can change the area if you want. You also can change the grid it has been retrieved. So, you can choose which grid you want. There's no much point to go to a grid finer than 1.5 by 1.5 because all the data has been archived into this grid, but you may want to retrieve the data in 2.5 by 2.5 degree grid if you want a larger cell. I mean, for example, for MGO indices, they are typically computed on 2.5 by 2.5 degree grid. And that makes the file much smaller and much easier to retrieve. Well, each model has its own resolution. I mean, some are 50 kilometers, so that would be more like a 0.5 by 0.5 degree grid. Some others, like Australia, can be 250 kilometers. But on the database, all of them, except the one which are very coarse resolution, are on 1.5 by 1.5 degree grid. That's what you would get on S2S database.
And why do we have
0.125? Well, that's a default from ECMWF, because we are very fine. We use the same menu for the high resolution model, which is a 16-kilometer model. So. It's not very practical. I mean, I don't know why you would do that with S2S. We don't have this resolution there. Yes. Yeah. You should be below this. Okay. So this is a way to, and then last thing, when you are finished, you simply select the retrieve grid, and then it will generate the file into your machine. So I will go back to the presentation, because there are a few important points to mention. So there's two ways to get the S2S database. This is what I show now was a web interface. So that's what we just demonstrated. And as I said, it's a discovery tool. It's very strongly recommended for the first-time users. If you have never used S2S, go there, give you a very good idea of what is available, what is the structure of each module. As I said, each module is different. It's a way for you to explore what is how it is structured. And it's easy to retrieve the data. That's very visual, easy to use, and it's good for small retrievals. Now, if you are a more advanced one, we strongly recommend to go to Web API, and which is basically to run a Python. It's a way to run Python script on your own computer. So you need to register. You need to install a Web API key. I mean, if you go to this website, it will tell you what to do to install this software into your own computer. And then you run the Python in your own computer, which will fetch the data at CMWF and bring it back to you automatically. So it's very brilliant. I mean, you can run it on your laptop, on anything. You will get the data automatically. The problem with the Web API is that you need to know in advance what you want, what is the structure of the model, basically, and that's where actually the web interface is useful, because then it can give you example actually of Web API scripts. So it's very nice for intensive S2S data retrievals. So it's recommended for advanced users. And what is important too is that the retrievals can be optimized, which is much more difficult from the web interface. So I will come to that a bit later. So this is a web interface I showed. And if you go, as I say, to the script, you can get here the Python script. It's not very easy to see, which gives you an example of Web API command for the data you have wanted to retrieve from the web interface. So what you can do is to copy this script and to run it on your own laptop and it will, or desktop, and it will retrieve the data automatically. So it's a way to understand the syntax. Myself, I don't know much about Python, but it's very easy to retrieve data from that because you see here's a list of dates. So if you want more dates, you can add more. You can include that inside the script and specify the step you want, all the start dates. So you can embed all that into your own scripts. And it's, I would say, relatively easy to understand. It's in a Mars language. It follows the Mars language.
You don't need to know Python.
I don't know Python, but I use it all the time, Web API, basically. So I mentioned that the fact that you can change area on grid. So that's another example of Web API script. So you have the dates. You don't care about class or data set. You have the origin ECMF, which means you retrieve ECMWF model. Left up, you surface variable. The parameter is 165. It's a bit obscure, but you can say explicitly that's 2T, 2 meter temperature for 2T, and so on. And steps, you have the list of steps you want to retrieve, and that's it. And the target is change.me, which we create a file called change.me. Well, you can put the name you want.
Okay. For the CMWF Web API call,
yes.
There is some quick links, and the package public, which directly link we should go.
For the CMWF, for the Web API, Tomorrow's lab, we show that, yes. We go more to detail, yes. We will do that tomorrow, yes. So the second one, which is important, is the reforecast. So this one is quite complex, much more complex than real-time forecast, because what is very important information here is that probably one to take home is that here the reforecast or uncast here archive with two dates in addition to the steps. So... So you have three time dimensions. The one is the steps. So you have the uncast date, which is the actual start date of the reforecast. For example, 1999-01-01, 1st January 1999. And then you have what we call a model version date, which is attached to the reforecast, which is, for example, 2014-01-01 for Bureau of Meteorology. So if you go to the web interface, you don't need to know that by heart. You will, it will be coded by, you will find that in the menu. So why do we need two dates? To do a model version date. The reason is that that we want to avoid the reforecast to be overwritten. So if we take a simple case NSEP, which is a fixed reforecast, we are using what is in S2S now is CFS version 2, which has a reforecast from 1999 to 2010, spanning all the days. But what happens when we go to the next version of NSEP, which will be CFS version 3? You will have another fixed reforecast, which will span exactly, probably maybe more, but at least a lot of those dates. And if we don't have this model version date, then it will overwrite the first one. And people won't no longer be able to calibrate the old real-time forecast from NSEP. So that's why we needed to add this additional information, which dimension, which is model version date. So it's a bit complicated, yeah? Because for fixed reforecast, there is one model version date by model version. So it's easy. For NSEP CFS version 2, all the reforecasts right now are coded with a model version date, which is 2011.0301, which is the first date when the model was became operational. That's the rule for fixed reforecast. Okay? For real time, for on-the-fly reforecast, is a bit more complicated because here's a model version date as the same day and same month. So the reforecasts are used to calibrate a real time forecast. So the model version date will have the same day, same month as the reforecast date. And cast that, but with the year of the model version date. So let's look at an example. If I go
so you
back.
You thought you were here for a workshop on meteorology, but you have five dimensions in time.
So if you select a reforecast, you will see the menu is a little bit different from the real time forecast. If I select it, it's a bit slow. Okay. So I select, I will go for an easy one. First, NSEP, which is a fixed reforecast. So you see this model version date, 2011.0301. You have no other choice than this one. You can ignore the top here for NSEP. It doesn't add much more. Because you have all the ANCAST date here on the menu on the right, once a day. So this date will be important later on when you have another version of a CFS. If you want to calibrate a real-time forecast, you put the date of your real-time forecast, and it will tell you automatically what is the model version date you should use. Because, I don't know, in 2019, 1st January 2019, you may have the choice between CFS version 2 or CFS version 3. And if you put the date of 2019.0101, it will know that you need to use the CFS version 3, and will give you automatically the model version date of CFS version 3, and what are the ANCAST date possible available for this. Okay? And the rest of the menu is the same as for real-time forecast. You select your step, parameter, and then you retrieve the grid. So you can select here your reforecast dates, and you go.
For the
I am coming to that.
It's the same as the real-time forecast
thing. Yes, exactly. So here is ACMWF, for example, which here I think is the only example of on-the-fly model. You can see that for 2015-12-07, 12 December 2015, that's all the reforecasts which are available for this model version date, so which go from two, so the last 20 years, from 2014-12-07 to 1995-12-07. So here you have a lot of version dates. You have all of them since the beginning of January. If you want to calibrate the 1st January 2015, then you click on this one, and it will generate, it will take a bit of time, all the, it will give you the list of reforecast date you have for 1st of January.
So, I actually found this very...
Here, we get it, the 20th January.
The model version is not actually changing between a lot of those dates. The reason why I found this very confusing is because I think that the key present day date uniquely identifies the model version anyway. That's why I was.
So that's one. Yeah, this menu is a bit confusing. You can ignore it for the time being. It's a way also to use it here to know, because the model on the fly is changing. And if you introduce a real time date, it will tell you what are the model version date, which have the same model version as your real time. Okay, if you are, for example, on 1st of June 2015, you may not know which are the reforecasts which are using the same model version. So normally, on 1st of June 2015, the list of model version dates should be the one which have the same model version cycle, the same cycle as the one of the real-time data. That's the way. It's a bit complicated. My best advice is at the beginning, ignore this real-time date. Just look at the model version dates and list of uncast here. That would be simpler, okay? So that's, no. Anyway, tomorrow you will have a practice and you will see how it works. I have been through that. And that's an example of WebEA command for reforecast, which is a bit different from real-time forecast. You can see that the stream is no longer info but ENFH. And you have two dates, a date which is in fact the model version date, so 2011-0301 for NCEP, and edge date, which is a real uncast date, the date of the forecast start, reforecast start, which is the 8th of November 2010. Okay? So, I want to spend some time also on an important point, which is the efficient data retrieval. So it's important to understand how the data is organized on ECMWF. First of all, the data is not archived on disk. It's not the usual FTP website where the data is on, you need to know the file names. You retrieve the file names, which is a big file, and then you extract what you need from that. Here is an organized database, which means you get what you ask. You want one parameter only, one single date. So you will just get a tiny file, which will contain this only small data. But the data is archived on TEPS, which means that each time you do a request, it is queued. And then you have a robot which is picking up, which is first of all looking where is your data, how many TEPS you need to retrieve. And then it will go retrieve the TEPS, extract the data you need, and send it to you. No, she's not a robot, no. I mean, as I discussed with Adrian, the whole time it was a real person taking the tapes. And when I was at GFDL 20 years ago, it was actually a person doing that. And one night I got a phone call from this guy asking me, why on earth do you need 100 times the same tape? You have to keep uploading the same tape 100 times. So anyway, what is important to know is that when you send a request, there will be three of your requests will be treated, processed at a time. Okay, a maximum of three. The rest will be queued. So which means that when you submit a request, you may be lucky and get your data within the next seconds, or it can take one day in some occasion. And this time can be function of the number of steps you ask. If your script or if your request is very inefficient and you are asking 25 steps, it's clear you will be in the bottom of the queue, and people who are asking just one step will have priority over you. That's why you need to really be efficient in the way you write your web API script when you really ask very, very big requests, because that can be fundamental. And that can annoy a lot of people at SMWF if your requests are very inefficient. As Adrian said, if you keep asking the same step 100 times, you will start to have some complaints, even if not physically someone doing it.
And you won't notice that so much this week, because we're working in a lab, and so what happens is, when you get data from a tape, it doesn't just take the tape and then send the information to you. What it does is it takes it and puts it onto a disk cache. So you won't notice that so much this week if we're all taking the same data in the class, because once one of us gets it, the others will just get it from the disk cache and it'll be much faster. But then you might think, well, it's not so much a problem, I won't worry about that. But then when you get home and you start to work more extensively, then you'll really notice your performance getting killed if you're not working on the efficiency, because then you'll be going to need things off the tape and you won't be accessing the cache anymore. So.
That's quite important information too. So as I said, your request is queued. It's not automatic. We have the problem several times from users who think this should be automatic. So they send a request. They see that 10 minutes later they get nothing. So they think the request is dead. They resubmit it.
Yeah.
They resubmit it 20 times and then they clog the system and everything goes down. So be patient. And if you kill the request on your side, doesn't mean the request is dead on our side. The SMWF is still there. Yes, yes, it is, yeah.
Except for Wednesdays.
Except Wednesdays, there is a one-hour session. So it's important to understand how the data is archived on TEP You have, first of all, to limit the number of steps you are requesting and try to retrieve as much as possible from one given step. That's why there is a sort of here a tree of the organization of the data onto steps. Time, the upper level is a class, then streams, then version type, year, month, type level, date, time, for instance. So I will go more in details for ECMWF. That's an example of the way the data is organized with the ECMWF, BOM, NSEP, GMA data. At the upper loop, you have BOM, ECMWF, NSEP, GMA, which means do not ask on the same request data from two different centers because they will absolutely be in completely different steps. Okay? Then you choose this real-time or reforecast. What type of data, control forecast or perturb forecast, is the next level. A type of level, single level or pressure levels, so they are likely to be in different steps. Model version dates, then uncast dates, time on steps, members, levels, and parameters. Okay? So parameters, so for one given date, there is very good chance that all the parameters, all the pressure level, all the members are on the same step. Actually, those steps contain a few terabytes, so you have good chance to get it. So let's take an example. Yeah.
So you'll notice, again, the website gives you a clue about this order, so you don't necessarily need this, because the website structure was designed to reflect this priority. So if you notice, like the left-hand menu had the center, and so it wasn't really easy to click. You can't click more than one center, because that's at the top. They don't want an inefficient retrieval. All of the low-level lines on this slide, they're all the things on the right-hand side where you can click several at once. So the website as well gives you an idea of that hierarchy because the things you can select multiple parameters, you know, they're pretty low on that list and they're likely to be on the same tape. And on the left-hand side where, if you remember, there was another option, reforecast or real-time, that was on the left-hand side. You couldn't do both, it was one or the other, that's near the top. So I just wanted to flag that similarity.
That's a good point. So here's an example, for example. If you are really efficient, you can retrieve up to 1 terabyte of data per day. We have one user in the US in Cola who is able to retrieve 1 terabyte of S2S data. He did a lot of work on optimization, and is 100 times faster than if he didn't do this optimization. So here, I take an example. You want 2 meter temperature, 2D, SST, CIs, 4 variables, for NSEP, CMA, for all the forecast data, for all the perturb forecast. So a very bad retrieval will be to loop over the ensemble number on daily mean variable, saying I want ensemble number 1 for 2 meter temperature, then I want ensemble number 2 for 2 meter temperature, and so on, because you will keep asking the same step over and over and over. What is a better script is to loop on the models and loop on the start date and retrieve all the perturb forecasts, all the daily means variable together. So there are examples in the wiki pages. If you go to the BOM model, you will see a web page for the reforecast efficiency retrieval. And that's the script that this guy from actually Cola used, where here he has, for example, for one single date, so one single uncast date, all the pressure levels, all the parameters, all the steps, all the perturbation forecast, all of them will be in one date. He loops over the dates and retrieves everything for one single uncast date. He retrieves everything he can. And that's where you go much faster. Whereas if he was looping over the number of ensemble members with all the uncast data here, he would keep requesting. He would request many steps at the same time on many, many times the same request, the same steps. Okay, so you have more information on S2S data at home. Yes, I wanted to point out a few interesting web pages in the documentation. One, if you click on parameters, you get all the list of parameters, what is the abbreviation, which is useful for the web API scripts, because that's what you can put in the command line. What is the unit of your data? And if it's an instantaneous daily average or accumulated fields, and if it's 6 hourly or 24 hourly. So that's an information, once again, you can get directly from the web page, from the web, from the data portal, but it's sometimes nice to have it directly. You have another web page, wiki page, will give you the status. I mean, if you click here on progress status, it will tell you what is available now, what are the latest news about the database. So here it tells you, for example, 7 models are operational. Some others are not are in progress. And each time one new model becomes operational, it will be updated, this web page is updated. Okay? And then you have a web page for news, which tells you the latest news about the web page, what are the issues with the data, which one are missing, if there is missing, if there is holes, stuff like that. And if you click more in issues with data, you can see, for example, if there is a problem with one data set. For example, we discovered recently that the temperature in coastal region with the Bureau of Meteorology model were wrong near the coastal, near the coast. Sometimes you can get a 2 meter temperature of 600 degrees in some points, a few local points. So this is notified here, so that people are aware that there is a problem with this data and to be careful when they use it. And I think I will, an important one too is the provided parameters. Once again, this is an information you can get directly from the data portal by clicking each model. But this is here a table telling you for each model what is available, which parameters you can find and which you do not find. For example, HMCR from Russia, there is no 10 hectopascal, that's the only one. But if you look at 10 meter U, you can see a few, one center, Austria doesn't provide 10 meter U on the one. So you can see in advance what is available and what is not available for each model.
So precipitation is
well, it's below. Okay, I need to go to the web page to, because it's a long list. So if I go to the project, I go to model description. Okay. And, well, it's a bit blurry, to be honest. We have to put it in a development phase, progress status, provided parameters. Oh, the colors don't appear. It's bizarre. Well, I don't know why here, but the colors do not appear. But the total precipitation is here. So some models are 6 hourly. You can see few models are 24 hourly. So that's something that is notified here. So if you go to this one, it will be GMA. For GMA, there is no 6 hourly total precipitation, for instance.
And what's the difference between precipitation and...
Well, total precipitation is a sum of convective precipitation on a large scale precipitation. So, I mean, Adriana knows more, but it's a bit of a fuzzy definition because it may depend a lot on the model physics, what it means.
I would always just take total precipitation unless you really want to go into the nitty gritty of the parameterization of the particular piece of the same as.
I can see the blue now.
The waters turn into rainfall, so that's what's actually seems to rain out in the convection apparatus, and then what's the train goes into the cloud scheme, and then the cloud may also produce just back and forth precipitation.
I mean, is there any specific reason why we want to use the convective precipitation?
Well, there might be some particular uses that might be interested in convection in the area, intense rainfall, whatever, but nearly 99 or 999 uses out of 1,000, all they did, well, because all they used to be was separate convective from the large scale, and all people used to do is retrieve both and have them together. So it's extremely rare that you want to use them, and it's very much a model product.
That's why actually the total precipitation is available 6 hourly, but convective precipitation we just provided 24 hourly because we don't expect many people to look at it. Okay, and I think that's more or less what I wanted to mention. And what time for practice for tomorrow? So tomorrow will be an opportunity to do some exercise to retrieve the data. First from the data portal, I think that's important people understand how it works. And if we have time tomorrow, maybe Web API, otherwise later this week.
So the idea of the Web API is how does people be working on a set of scripts, and she's set them up on the desktop, so there'll be a very simple recipe to follow just to get things going on the desktops already, actually doing testing that here. But the idea will be as well to make sure you know how to, and if possible, so if you have a laptop with you, you can try and help to actually set that up, so when you go home, you have that on the laptop, you can use the Web API tool, actually running and working with the keys set up.
is the wiki page. It's very easy to follow. I just followed it. I'm hardly a Python modeler or anything myself. It was very, very easy to set up on a Linux box.
I think I have a link somewhere.
Yeah.
Wiki page. But I don't know if I can click on it, actually. Oh, yes. It works. So there's some simple instruction here, which you have to follow. I did it a long time ago. If I remember, you have to just to retrieve an executable. And
is the procedure easy? Yes. And that's
yes, that's all you need to know.
But it is an ITD-like recipe, but really easy. It's like doing plain buns. It's not like a Christmas cake or something.
Yeah, in fact, that's access public. That's where really they explain you how to install the key on the libraries.
Perhaps I said, Howard has set up a script that does these steps on the local desktops, but then when you understand how to write it, the idea will be you can also follow these steps and set it up on your laptop.
So that's a useful web page, actually, which tells you also, give you also examples after of Pythons and some examples from S2S. Actually, there's even S2S examples there. So you can go. The BOM reforecast example. You have an example for each module.
So
you just need to copy that and just run it on your computer once this key is installed into your computer.
The web page tomorrow.
Yes. Okay?
Can we use the Mars as well? Or
if you have access to Mars? Then you can, it's better. I mean, you can.
It's authorized or.
But you need to be logged on to the ECMWF machine.
Yes.
So you need to have a member state account that. That's something that's more internal. So the Python Web API is a script that you can run remotely.
Yes.
I actually much prefer, I think for most users, it's far, far, far more useful than going to. Because if you do.
You don't need to log on.
You need to log on to ECMWF, run the Mars script to retrieve the data. You then still have to transfer it back, so you then have to open an SFTP link, transfer it back to your home machine. Why go to all that bother? Just use the web API, set up a key, and you just make a request directly from your desktop, your laptop, in your office. Just say, I want this, and the web API handles all of it. It goes there, gets the data off the archive, transfers it back over to the local machine, and presto, you basically all the steps of logging on, running Mars, FTPing the data back, just one simple
And if you are familiar with Mars, you will recognize that's really the Mars command. That's exactly like a Mars retrieval command. With the syntax, it's slightly different.
Because
I saw
that there is a Mars access as well as a public data set.
But Mars access is more for people who are member state, actually. It's more for member state, so for special accounts.
We weren't intending to go for any Mars access,
no.
Because for most users in the room, they won't have that facility to log on and use the Mars archive access. And as I said, it's more inefficient.
Okay, any questions?
Not. I think we'll close the day.
Yes.
6 o'clock onwards, we'll be up in the canteen area there to get to know each other. I think you all know which groups you are in tomorrow morning. Yes, in spite of my efforts to make it as confusing as possible this morning, but I think we're okay for tomorrow morning. No other questions? Have I forgotten anything? If I have, I'll say tomorrow.
Thank you.
Shuttles. Don't say the shuttles times.
Oh, yes.
Look up now, see if I can find the shuttle.